So in the last class, we were designing this hoist, which lifted a load of 20 kilonewton at 100 meter per minute linear velocity. The hoist drum has a diameter of 600 mm and this is rotated with the help of a motor running at 1440 rpm. The motor and the drum shaft are connected using worm and worm wheel. We are expected to design this worm and worm wheel to find the power of the motor and the velocity ratio. So this is the assembly. This is a motor which is operating a worm. Worm is normally mounted on the input shaft. This is connected to the worm wheel. And on the worm wheel shaft, we also have this hoist drum. And this drum is lifting the weight. This is in the side view, their worm would look like this. This is the wheel. We don't know what is the diameter of the gear. So initially we are assuming the diameter of gear is same as that of hoist drum. So we'll start with calculation of rated power. For lifting this much weight at this linear velocity, this is the power required, which should be available at this drum. And so the design power is the rated power multiplied by the service factor, which we have taken from the given table for motor and elevator and crane hoist. The service factor is given as 1.75. You could further divide this with the efficiency of worm and worm wheel. And by thumb rule, we also have the efficiency in terms of velocity ratio. So you probably would end up getting PD slightly higher than this or PR slightly higher than this. Next to 58.3 kilowatt, the available standard motor would be of 60 kilowatt. So we have selected a motor with design power as 60 kilowatt running at 1440 RPM. Worm is mounted on the motor shaft and so RPM of worm is 1440. Assuming the diameter of the gear is same as diameter of the drum, we are converting this linear velocity of the hoist drum into its angular RPM because diameter is given. So we get the RPM of drum as 53 RPM, which we are also assuming to be the RPM of the gear. So this is 53 and so the velocity ratio comes out to be 1440 by 53. And this is nothing but 27. From the design data book for velocity ratio 27, it says that the number of starts should be 2, which we are taking as number of teeth on the worm. For this velocity ratio, number of teeth on the worm as 2, we can find out number of teeth on the gear, which is velocity ratio times number of teeth on the worm. And we get number of teeth on the gear as 54. As I said, for worm and worm wheel, we design only the worm wheel and the dimensions of worm we directly select from the design data book. Assuming the module as M in millimeters, we get the value of TG, VP, FT, everything in terms of M. And then for the calculation of beam strength, we assume the material properties. Again, the service condition is not given, so we are going with medium service condition. You can as well go with light service condition. Material for gear is usually selected as phosphor bronze to reduce the friction. For this material, S0 is 84 MPa. For getting the value of Lewis form factor, this is the formula given for which you will need pressure angle phi n. And for the pressure angle, you would need the lead angle. The lead angle depends upon the lead and the worm diameter, but if those values are not available, then for compact design, this is another formula given in the design data book. We know NG by NW is given as 27. Find the cube root, tan inverse of this is a lead angle. Again, from the design data book, for this value of lead angle, the value of pressure angle comes out to be 20 degrees, and if phi n is 20, you can calculate the value of y. So we have S0, we have y, module is m, CV, since gear is rotating at very low RPM, the value of CV for worm and worm wheel will usually assume as 0.75. Next comes the value of B. B is the face width. Formula for face width is given in terms of circular pitch, 2.38 PC plus 6.25, where PC is pi times M. We cannot use this complete formula because then this equation would be too complicated in M cube, M square, M. And so initially we are ignoring this term 6.25 so that we simplify this expression. Later when we get the value of module, we'll be using this term 6.25. And so B is taken as 2.38 times pi M and you get an equation in M cube from which you get the module as 12.96. Next standard value of module available is 16. For this module, we get the value of dG, VP, the static force required for the power transmission. We calculate CV in terms of VP. And there is no formula defined for dynamic load in case of worm and worm wheel. So FD, the dynamic load, will find out as static load upon CV. You know that CV is a factor which takes into account the incremental load. So if you divide it by this, the value of FD comes out to be 35 kilonewton, where FT is 25 kilonewton. We have to check this with the beam strength. And now the beam strength value without CV, S0 remains the same, Y is same. M value is 16 and you can now take actual value of B, including 6.25 and M value as 16. Make sure your FB comes out to be greater than FD. If this condition is true, then this is safe in bending. Then we have to check for its wear strength. The formula for wear strength is given in terms of diameter of the gear, face width, and a term K2, which depends upon the material. And we get that its wear strength is 76 kilonewton, which is definitely greater than its dynamic load, 35 kilonewton. So it is safe in wear as well. Moving on, I told you for worm and worm wheel, the biggest limitation is its heat generation. So we have to design it from heat generation perspective as well as strength point of view. So from strength consideration, we have seen this is quite safe. We have to check from heat dissipation point of view. Now there is an empirical formula which says for a given center distance and velocity ratio, what is its maximum rated power capacity? So we find out the center distance, which is sum of its radii taken in this plane upon its velocity ratio. C should be in meter and you will get power in kilowatt. Don't try to balance it dimensionally because this is an empirical formula and these terms, they are taking care of other units. So this is 35 kilowatt. So with this combination of DW, DG, module, diameter, the maximum heat which it can, the maximum rated power which this entire assembly can have is 35 kilowatt. Whereas, as per our calculations, for the given load to be lifted at a given RPM or with a given linear speed, the rated power we have taken is 33.3, so which is well within this limit. So you have to always check that this PR from heat generated point of view, this should be greater than the actual rated power. If this condition holds true, then we say this is safe from heat generation point of view. And then we have to calculate what is the heat generated in terms of its efficiency and the rated power. We'll again take the actual rated power, 33.3 kilowatt. For finding out efficiency, we have already derived this expression in terms of theta, mu and lambda. Lambda, you know it is 18 degrees. For getting the value of mu, this depends upon what is its rubbing velocity. This is the formula for rubbing velocity, which we have already derived. NW, you know, for getting DW, you have to again refer to the design data book, which gives you the diameter of the worm. Use these values, get the rubbing velocity in meter per minute. Depending upon what is the magnitude of PR, we have the formula for coefficient of friction mu. And in terms of pressure angle and lead angle lambda, we have the value for theta. Theta is the angle which the final resultant makes with the resultant of axial and tangential force. This comes out to be 19 degrees, and from which you got efficiency as 82%. So give me the value of heat generated. What was the value for heat generated? Sarthak? Sarthak? Roll number 25. Surya? Rated power is 33 kilowatt, efficiency is 82%. Give me what is heat generated. Roll number 27. Are you there? 27. BT1927, 5.94 kilowatt is heat generated. Others, please confirm. Surya, are you getting the same value? Bharti? Bharti has given me the answer. Okay, so it's around 6 kilowatt. Use your own values. And now we are, either we assume what is the rise in temperature and get the heat dissipated, or we equate heat generated with heat dissipated and check what is the value of delta T, that is rise in the oil temperature. Value of K is given. And area is this area which is responsible for heat dissipation. So this is length of the worm wheel face. LW given in the data book in terms of TC and TW. DW is a diameter of the worm, DG is a diameter of the gear. So this area is this rectangular area LW to DW plus pi by 4 DG square. Give me what is area first. What is this area responsible for heat dissipation? Point 0.62 meter, 0.62 square meter, 10 cube. Others, please confirm. 0.62. Okay. Looks good. value of k is given, value of a is known. Equate this with hd and give me what is the rise in the oil temperature. We have to convert the area in millimeter square. What is 24 Bharti? Is that temperature? Okay. So you are getting around 24 to 25 degrees rise in the oil temperature. 24. Others, please confirm. Rushika, Vaishnavi, Pratyusha. 24. Okay. So as long as this value is less than 60 degrees, we say this is safe from heat generation point of view. Yeah, 25 degrees, 24 degrees. Heat generation point of view. Okay, now you are free to ask questions that you have. Any questions? Else we go for the next problem. Atharva Devansh, Shravani. No questions. Okay. Let's go for next question. We'll try to find out what are the forces acting on the bearing because of Herman Worm wheel. We'll try to finish off this problem in 40 minutes. A two-teeth right-hand worm, two-teeth right-hand worm gear transmits 0.75 kilowatt at 1200 RPM. A 30-teeth worm, to a 30-teeth worm gear in a milling machine. In a milling machine, the worm has an axial pitch. Worm has an axial pitch of 13 mm and the pitch diameter of 50 mm. Length of its face is 63 mm. Face width of the gear is 25 mm and the pressure angle is 14.5 degrees. Find the center distance between the two shafts. Lead angle and the forces exerted by the bearing on the gear shaft and the output torque. Check if it is suitable for continuous duty. So with so many data, so much of data is given. What is the velocity ratio? What is velocity ratio given? Shriya? Surya, what is the RPM for the gear? Velocity ratio is 15. What is the RPM for gear? RPM for gear, Rushika?
Ma'am, number of teeth is given, so can we directly calculate from that?
RPM, yes. Velocity ratio is divided by 100 by 15.
Oh, okay.
So it is 1200 by 15. You get 80. So we are reducing it from 1200 RPM to 80 RPM. Then for the worm, axial pitch is given as 13. DW is given, LW is given. Length of the face 63, and for the gear, face width is given, pressure angle is given. If the axial pitch is given, what is the important and the critical data that is given in the problem? Yeah, anyone? Module, yes. So, as you know, for worm and worm wheel to mesh, the axial pitch for the worm must be equal to the circular pitch for the gear. And if this is 13, circular pitch is pi times n. So, give me module. Give me the module, please. 13 by m. Now, once the module is known, you know how the problem simplifies. Now, this is no more a design problem. It's like any other numerical. So, diameter of gear is m times t. 13 by pi times number of teeth on the gear. So you know what is dg. This is the exact value of dg without rounding it up to the next value. Because for this two to mesh, let's go with the same module, 4.14. Give me the value of dg and then we'll find out what is the center distance. 124. How do you get center distance? How do you get center distance between the two shafts? Pratyusha? Dg plus dw by 2. Everything known, give me the form, give me the answer. It is 7.1. Perfect. Lead, distance traveled in one rotation. How do you get the value of lead? Lead for any screw or worm is Athar. TW times number of starts times its axial pitch. So this is axial pitch is 13, number of starts 2. So lead comes out to be 26. And how do you get lead angle now? Lead angle. Karthik. Lead angle is lead upon pi dw. The distance traveled is equal to lead in one rotation of worm. This angle is lambda. Give me the value of lambda. Give me this value. 9 degrees. Okay, 9.39, 9.4. What next? What will be your next step? You already have module. What is our next step? FT. Yes. We'll find out FT. We'll check if it is safe for continuous duty for its wear strength. And then from FT, we'll find out what is the axial force and what is the radial force. So for FT, we need VP. And the design power. Rated power is given how much? 0.75 kilowatt. Get the design power. For the milling machine operation, what is the value of K given? table 11.5. What is the value of k? Yes, go ahead with 1.25. And Vp, which is pi dg ng, everything known, upon 60 into 1000. Give me ft please. One point 8 kilonewton. Okay. One point 8. Deepika, roll number 47. Give me the answers. Dhruv, 54. Next, we have to find out what is FD. For FD, we have to find out CV. Now for CV, since you know what is the value of VP, give me the value of VP first and then CV. CV is 6 upon 6 plus VP. What is VP? Dhruv, you are there, 54. Ananta, please mark Dhruv absent on number 54. Riddhima?
Yes, ma'am.
What is the value of VP?
0.519.
0.519. Okay, so I'll take 0.52. Okay, give me CV. CV, is that 0.92, Saurabh? Okay. Get FB. We'll use phosphor bronze, it's not 84. Why? Depends upon phi n. Pressure angle is 14.5 degrees. Give me the value of y. M is 13 by pi. B value is again given. If you are using CV, we'll be comparing this FB with FT. And when you are not using CV, we'll be comparing it with FD. You know that. Yes, so Y comes out to be 0.314. M is 13 by pi. B is 25. CV is 0.92. This is FB with CV, which must come out greater than FT. Give me this FB. Two, five, one, one. Others please confirm. Yes, So this is 2.5 kilonewton greater than Ft. So this is Fb with Cv. Is greater than static force. So this is safe. How do you get Fd here? How to find the dynamic load Fd? Good. That is Ft by Cv. It is the static load divided by Cv. Static load is 1.8 kN, Cv is 0.92. So give me what is Fd. Also give me what is Fb without Cv. Fd is 1.95 kN. Good. And what is Fb without Cv? Definitely greater than this. Fb without Cv is 2.7 kN. 2.72. Good. So this is again quite safe. So your Fb is greater than Fd. So this is safe in dynamic load. Quickly check for Fw and then we have to calculate the forces. Fw is pitch circle diameter for the gear into the face width into K2. For phosphor bronze it is 0.7. What is 2.7? This is Fb without Cv. Give me Fw. Let's see if it comes out to be greater than Fd. Give me Fw quickly. Kaustubh, 62, you are there. 2.17 is Fw, which is greater than Fd, 1.95. So this is safe for continuous duty. Its wear strength is greater than the dynamic load coming on it. So this is suitable for continuous duty. Next part is we have to find out what is the output torque and what are the forces coming over it. So the output torque is the torque available at the gear shaft. So this is P by W at the gear shaft. But this is the power available at the worm shaft. And the power available at the gear shaft will be multiplied with its efficiency. So the power available at the output shaft would be less. So if you directly get the design power upon omega, this would be the torque available at the input shaft. When we multiply it with efficiency, this is the torque available at the output shaft. And for efficiency, you know, we have to again use the formula cos theta minus mu tan lambda. And for this value of efficiency, you have to get the quickly the value of mu, for which you need the value of Vr. Give me the values quickly, please. Lambda, you know it is 9 point. How much you got? 9.4. Give me VR, DW, LW, everything is known. MW. Give me VR and give me mu. Vedant Mahore, 64. Manas. VR is 191. What is mu for this? Meter per minute. What is mu for this value of VR? 0.025 plus VR upon 20,000. Point 0.034. What is theta? Tan theta is tan pi n into cos lambda. What is theta? Theta is 14.3. Good, very quick. And so what is efficiency? Efficiency 82%. Good. What is the efficiency for spur gear and helical gear? Atharva? Atharva? It's almost 96 to 98%, whereas for worm and worm wheel, the efficiency goes down to 82%. That is the biggest limitation. So give me the output torque. This is the torque at the gear shaft. Design power into efficiency by omega. Give me the torque, please. Where are you, postal answers? Sushmita? torque is coming out to be 96. Ayush, what is 96? Is that torque? Okay. Others, please confirm. Athara, what is your value of torque? Sushmita, Pratyusha, 91. Okay, so we'll go with 91. Ayush, please check your answer. Next are the forces. We have to find out what are the forces acting on the bearing. Ft for gear, we have already calculated. What was the value? What is the tangential force for the gear equivalent to for the worm? What this force indicates in case for worm? This is axial for worm. And the tangential force for the worm would be the torque available at the worm shaft upon the angular velocity. This would be the input torque. Which is same as the power upon the peripheral velocity. Output torque, we are multiplying with the efficiency. For the input torque, it is the power available at the input shaft. So what is the Ft value available at the worm? This value will also be equal to the axial force at the gear. Is it 3.46? So much variation. 1.8, which is the axial force at the gear. And for FR, the radial for the worm is same as radial for the gear. which is FT for the worm. Multiplied by the formula in terms of theta and lambda. Theta, lambda and mu. This will be FR. And so at the bearing, if this is the wheel, there is this FT component acting here. FR acting here, this would be axial, and perpendicular to the board, this would be FP. Axial is along the axis of the gear, FR is the radial component, and FT is responsible for rotation of gear, which is perpendicular to this plane. So for the bearing, this axial and the tangential component both are acting in the axial direction, and this is the radial component. So while we are designing for the bearing, in the coming units we'll have to calculate all these forces for design of bearing. We'll have to get its reactions at the bearing, the way you do for a simply supported beam subjected to different kind of loading. How do we find out the reactions? Now this gear may not be situated exactly at the midpoint. So this might be 1/3 from the left bearing and 2/3 from the right bearing. So accordingly, we'll find out what are the reactions at the bearing. But while designing the bearing, we'll not be designing this, but we'll be calculating what are the forces coming on the gear shaft. Or if we have to design the bearings for the worm, then we'll have to find out what are the forces coming on the worm. And accordingly, we'll find out the reactions on the worm. So that's all for today. So this ends the topic gear. Next class, tomorrow we are going to start with belt drives. So we'll start with flat belt, then V belt, and then the chain drive. Now you're free to ask questions now. Value of FR, have you calculated the radial force? .32, 0.344 should be good. Athara, what is 2.32? 2.31 FR. Saurav, what is 0.344? 2.31 FR. Please check your answers. What is the value? 2.3 or 0.34. How did we get FTG? FTG we have already calculated before calculating this. This is FT for gear. PD by VP. Here we hadn't taken efficiency, right? Efficiency was missing here. So from this torque, upon omega, get the value of FT from EA. From the torque available at the gear, get the value of FT. So your values would slightly change, would reduce by 82%. So you can recalculate these values and you can post in the group. Thank you all.